In this episode of Fenugreek Machining, we are going to make one gear, especially one gear for this here. It's a gear. So first I will cut the stock, do some drilling, and then it's partly a lathe job and partly a milling job. So let's go on with that one. This is how it ended up when I cut it from the stock. No big drama there, just angle grinder and that's it. So now I chuck it, and this is always how I do it. It's a three jaw chuck, and when you put this kind of stock, even if it seems to be round, it might not be round. So therefore I wiggle it there, like this, and then it stops wiggling, then you are there. And this is my slot number 0, I start with this, and then I tighten them each at their turn, go around the chuck. I was wondering about this, why you should do that, like that. But the thing is that the center concentricity depends not only on the jaws, but the spiral inside there. And when you tighten them like round like that, starting from the same point, at least you get repetitive it off center. But okay. So next step here is to face it. This is a pretty straightforward operation. Just put your tool there, tighten it securely, and what I usually do here is that I will use the compound for feeding, so that I will it's already there. What I will do, I will actually bring this to near the point where it starts to cut, and then I lock the carriage here, so the carriage doesn't move. I will feed with the compound, and then let's see what happens here. I'm fishing for the high spots here. Uneven, so I don't want to. Okay, I think this is that. And then I zero my compound here. Did you see that? No, you did not. You have to believe me. I have reset my dial here. I will take 0.25 millimeters first, and this one I can keep by hand because. It's very uneven cut. I just feed it by hand. Well, maybe I should zoom out so that you can see what I'm doing here. And now comes the hard part. This is always when you go to the center, it can break your tool because the zero radius cut. Now, next 0.25 millimeters, and it was quite. The feed is 76 hundredths of a millimeter. Per revolution, that is. And now it will almost clean it up. I can hear it still making those intermittent sounds, so it's not completely clean yet. something really strange. It makes these birds' nests. And it was also when I cut it with the angle grinder, it didn't make the normal sparks. It made very dull orange sparks. So this is not normal cold rolled mild steel. This is something else. But it works for me. And now if you urge to pick these up, always use pliers. This is something you... It's okay. I cannot see anything there. So, this is now faced. Next step is to drill a hole through that one. Okay. Well, this here is a Röhm chuck. It has a plastic outside, but well, let's see how this works. So, there you are. First is a spot drill. This is to make it so that it doesn't wander around. It's very, very short and stout drill. And now I can free my carriage because I would like to have it freely moving here. And since we don't need this this tool anymore, I will also remove it so that well, accidents can happen. So. Lock it there, and let's go. There you are. Spot drills are a little bit different than the center drills. They have a different angle here. It's suitable for drills. Then I will use a 6mm drill which goes through. Can it go through? Yes, it can. And we can still keep the speed. I think the speed is really nice. Let's see now, we need some rockol here. This is rockol, it's cutting fluid. And now I have to check that we have... Oh yeah, we have room there. Then I go back to that point. Okay, we can go a little bit nearer so that we can go through with one setup. Okay, let's do this. Jaha, okay. It doesn't like me. Not a good one. Man. Let's take another Röhm chuck. I have a better one, really. Huh. Damn. Well, this one is old and trusty. It's and when you put your drill into a chuck, always put it all the way through. Let's see, by the way, if... Yes, it reaches through, even if it's... Always put it all the way there it goes. This way it has a maximal grip, and... It doesn't, you know where the... It doesn't go into the chuck. Well, that chuck is not a good one. I probably need to do something. Much better. As I said, this stuff is something really strange. So the next step is, well, this chuck is really nice because, as you saw, this is this hold the drill really securely, and furthermore, when I loosen it, it goes like that. It's really a good one. There is actually a ball bearing inside there. No, it's not a ball bearing, it's a roller bearing. And yeah, it's a high quality chuck, this one. And then we take a less high quality chuck. This is, well, I don't know where it is coming from. Maybe China, maybe. If I think about the price, it might be Chinese. And this one I use because the other ones I have don't have the capacity for this. This is a 13 millimeter drill, which I just have ground. It might not work. But let's see, this one we need a little bit slower speed, not like that. Maybe I would like to take a little bit. Oh yeah, now it's good. And then I fill the hole with this oil. Let's see now, about there. So this is 13 millimeters. Let's see. Well, my ground was quite good actually. It's never good. You should not a lot better. I would say, I think we need to have a little bit more speed. Yeah. I have also noticed that the drills don't like to run in slow speeds. Too slow speeds, I mean. So there is a suitable speed, and then we have this too slow speed, and then we have too high speed. With too slow speed you get a little bit, I would say, strange finish in the hole, and it starts to make those sounds you heard. And this, as you can see, is not very easy. not the finest grind, but it works. And with us, with any tool, when you put it away, clean it before you put it away. Okay, this funny looking drill, this is a 13.8 millimeter pre-reaming drill. This will be used before axle reamer. So, because this is now Morse 1, we have to put Morse 1 to Morse 2 adapter there. And always when you put this on, just hammer them a little bit in there. And then, because this is Morse 3, we have to put yet another adapter here. So it is now Morse 2 to Morse 3, so stacking up. And now let's get rid of this chuck, which is... let's put this on. And how I do this, because I do it so that I feel when it starts to push the drill, so then I know that's the point where when I can slam it in. And now, this type of drill likes lubrication, and it also likes very slow, you turn it slowly. That's quite fast actually. No, it's okay. Is it okay? No, it's not okay. So we need to use back gear and... Yeah. So it's... Well, at the moment it's... 100 revolutions per minute. And this likes to have a lot of lubrication, so it's a mistake to run this drill dry. So this creates quite an exact 13.8 millimeter hole now. And it's a lot like a reamer. You don't run this drill backwards. It will ruin it, so you just push it through. And hope it doesn't break there. And you don't peck drill with this one. If you want a straight hole, you don't peck drill. You just push it through. Should be through. quite soon. Well, we are almost there. Yeah, there you are. Okay. That was a pre-reamer drill. And now I clean it before putting it away. Well, there is some rockol in it, but that's all right. Okay. Let's take the reamer itself. Okay. So, this one is a 14H7 reamer. You can read it there, maybe. I hope you can. And this one has the same syndrome. First you have to put the MOS 1, slam it in, bump, and then the MOS 2 to MOS 3. Okay. Yeah. And there you are. And now, again, this one also likes lubrication. This is almost empty. Well, so this is 14 millimeter reamer, and this is because the motor shaft is well, how come it's 14 millimeters? So now we just do this one. You push a little bit deeper, as deep as it as this wheel now goes, and then you pull it back. Why you need to push it past is that normally these have this is a little bit smaller in diameter at this end and larger here. So now we have a perfect hole there. It should be now exactly 14 millimeters. Yeah, it's really. Yeah, it is. It's really good. Okay. So now we have a hole, 14 millimeter hole there. Next step, make a mandrel. Waste material. So this was the test piece I used for the episode in the lathe safety issues, and well, it's 14.5 millimeters at the moment, and we need it to be 14. So we have only 0.5 millimeter to get out from that. Let's see now. Let's see now. Okay, if the jaws are clean, that was actually I was multi-processing. So, and this feels a little bit stiff. So, no stiff no more. Now I can put it there. And where is my zero? There it is. Okay. So this will become a mandrel, which I use to this piece will be glued here around. And, well, I believe that's the good place. Why I'm doing it like this is because there is no guarantee that the hole here is concentric with the outside. Usually when you drill with a drill a hole, it doesn't become totally concentric. It's somehow grooved. So, but now when I make this round thing here, and then when I glue it there, I can guarantee that every operation I make with the piece here will be concentric with this thing here. So let's tighten this again. Yeah. Okay. And sometimes now the next step is that I will face this and put a center in there. It's it should be quite well. It's okay. So do I even need a little bit more here? No, I don't. At the moment, I don't. So let's face it. That's the operation now. Again, I will attach this one, and then I will lock the carriage in place here somewhere like that. Then we need a little bit more speed here because this will be always when you are turning small diameters use a lot of speed. Well, let's see now how it squeals on me. This might do that. There you are. And there shouldn't be any nibble there, no. That, if you have a nibble in there, it will make your center drill to go aside. So therefore, no nibbles, please. Now, center drill. Well, you cannot see a lot of it when it's there. It's really there, buried into the chuck. And now, is the speed good for that? But we can always put it in back here. So. Okay, we have a center there. I made it quite large because this center is has a double use. First of all, I will use it here when I turn this diameter, and then it will also be used in the dividing head. So, therefore it is like that. Okay, that's clean. So now, and also when you made a center drill, you should clean this hole. Oh yeah. Some people use here like modeling wax or whatever to get it clean. So let's see how much we have room for development here. Not much, I believe. Well, it's exactly 14.5. Hopefully we have enough concentricity so that I don't get it wrong. And then we take this. And quite a lot of stick out because we need, well, the tool I'm going to use here is this. And it still has the bad insert I used in the episode for late safety, so I will change that one. And furthermore, let's see now. We need a little bit stick out here. This is not a very good practice, but in this case, because I need to go all the way near this point, and I want to keep my my compound like this, so I need some room for different things. And now, because we are not using the compound in this case, I will lock it like that. It's locked. And then we see that we have enough room here. Let's first retract it, and then we see that we have clearances here. Yes, we have. Good. So we can lock our compound here, tailstock, and then I will... when I tighten this, I will run it like that. I'm quite tight. That's good. Okay. And that's not good. That's okay, and we have that. And then I will set my stop somewhere. Somewhere like here. Like that. The stop is there. I check that the stop really works. It has proven to me that sometimes the stop slips, and I don't know that. Wrong direction. Okay, let's see. Yep, doesn't slip. And now I will touch it. Well, there you are. And it whistles. Yeah, of course it whistles. Then we take 0.25 millimeters. Let's hope it doesn't whistle all the way. Man. Let's see. Let's put a little bit more speed. More speed. Why did it do like that? Huh. Okay. Now. It's a little bit warm. That's funny, it shouldn't be. Now it should be 14.1. Well, it's 14.11. And this side is 14.11. 14.11. So, 11 hundredths of a millimeter away from that. Let's take 11. No, we are not taking 11. We are taking that's 0.1 and just a little bit more. Well, let's see. That's our final pass. Man, this is hard for your ears. A mistake you would make here was to get it away from the chuck. Don't do that. We need the concentricity we have now here. It's a little bit tight. Well, if it's so hard to get into there, it's probably tight enough for turning. No Loctite needed here. Oh yeah, a little bit more. Well, that was a press fit. That's enough. Now we have room to access this side, and all the features there. Now I'm cleaning this surface here. This workpiece, I didn't need to use Loctite to put it in. Actually, when I measured the shaft, it was this is 1/100 of a millimeter press fit, and it's really tight there. Hopefully, it doesn't start turning on me. Hopefully, we shall see about that. So now what I'm doing, I'm just peeling off, and then I need to turn it to dimension. The final length should be 35 millimeters. Now it's 44, so almost 10 millimeters must come off. Let's see, I'm at the moment taking very light cuts. I don't want to start turning. So, first cut. 0.25 millimeters, and then we go on from there. Let's see how this goes. Well, it was quite straight already. And you can tell this is hard material from the sound. Facing this multiple times was way too, it was tedious. So I stopped doing that. So this will be turned down to 18, this portion, 18 millimeters in diameter. First, very conservatively, only 0.25 millimeter cuts. Let's see. Run into a problem, and the problem is here. Probably you can see this is the insert I'm normally using for turning, and now if you can look here into very just under the insert, what is that? Well, it has been the chips have been eating this for their breakfast. And this is some crap Far East tool. I believe it's soft as baby ass. So, at the moment this is equal to scrap metal. So I took another insert here. I will show that to you now. This is Stora. A way better insert. I years back when I was beginning my career as a hobby machinist, I was donated this tool holder, and it has survived whatever. It's really hard, and well, yeah. At the moment, we are at our goal was 18 millimeters, so this is now 22. So we have a few more millimeters to go, and at the moment I'm running this at 1200, a little bit more than 1200 RPM. The feed is 0.07 of a millimeter per revolution, and the depth of cut, as said, 0.5 millimeter. So that should be 0.5 millimeter now. Yeah. So let's go. It behaves different, this one. It, the tip is better. It's not, it doesn't make those birds nests. Okay, I forgot to put the seal for the carriage stop. I need to put it there. But it will squeal at the end. No problem. And as you can see, there is a tool pressure. It has higher tool pressure because it wraps on the backstroke. The inserts I normally use, they have very low tool pressure, so therefore they don't do that rubbing when you pull them back. And now I need to have here a sealed here, so it doesn't put chips between the carriage stopper. Let's see that place, and then just put it with a magnet there. There it is. Now the chips cannot enter between my carriage stop. And well, yeah, 0.5 millimeter. Yeah, there you go. This is a carbide insert. The ones I'm normally using are Cerne. This is different. Well, it's different. But this makes better chips, I think. Stringy, but better. They are fluffier somehow, and more sharp. These are really sharp. You have to handle these with extreme caution. These are really... Oh! Okay, next 0.5 millimeter, and so on. Then we go. Well, I left the tool there now intentionally, because the next thing I'm going to do, I will pull in this tool into the face and then hand feed it out from there. This is And before I do that, I will lock the carriage like that, and then I will loosen the compound a little bit, and then we go. Just a little bit here. Okay. Well, that finished good.
Okay.
So, I decided to make this 30 tooth gear. This means that the outer diameter should be 31 millimeters because I'm using Module 1 cutters. This 30 teeth is right in between the range for cutter number 5. So it should be exactly, should be the best possible. That's what I'm aiming here. So let's see, first half a millimeter cut here. let's see how this goes. I have a carriage stop, so and I have checked all the clearings so that there shouldn't be no problem. But you never know. Let's see. For example, I don't know whether this starts wheeling. Oh man, the diameter here now is 32.03 at the moment. Yeah. Not fun. Here I am milling the teeth for this gear blank. Well, what I have done already, I dialed in this forge chuck. Then I centered this cutter so that it is on the center line. And then I adjusted the cutting depth to, 2.25 millimeters. Well, module 1 is really easy. So, first of all, you have the cutting depth, how you calculate it. So, it is, it consists of three components. One, there is addendum, then we have the deadendum, and then we have the clearance. Addendum is what is the upper part of the teeth, and then deadendum is the lower part of the teeth, and then clearance is at the very bottom of the teeth. And now addendum is 1 because it's module 1. Deadendum is also 1 because it's module 1. And then this clearance is 0.25 times module. So this means that 2.25 millimeters is the cut depth. And I have set it. The next thing, this is going to be a 30 teeth gear. So it has to be divided in 30 equal parts. So what I chose was a disc with 15 holes in it. And since this is 40 revolutions per one revolution here, it means that we have 40 times 15 holes, the whole circle. It's actually 600, quite exactly. If you multiply 15 with 40, you get 600. Okay, then this 600, if you divide that with 30, you get 20. So 20 holes for each tooth. So, well, I have set, because it's a 15-hole disc, so one revolution is 15 and then five more. So I have set these sector arms so that it will be five more. Well, couldn't be easier than that. And well, then I of course have this tailstock here, because it needs to be quite steady yeah, okay. And well, let's start with this one. I'm using a feed mechanism here, well, yeah, okay. And I'm lubricating this by putting the cutting oil on top of this cutter, so then it migrates slowly into the plates. Yeah, there you go. And I'm really feeding this really, really, really slowly. If you do this in a hurry, you will get bad results. And furthermore, I don't trust this how it holds on the shaft. So, yeah. And you can feel slight vibration here, actually. You can feel it. But it's not too bad. I believe this is okay. And in the machine feed, I have set a stop here so that I don't run into my chuck. The clearances are here really, really something. You have to be really careful when you do things like this. You can make gear teeth on your chuck. Actually you will ruin your cutter. Well, yeah, there is a horrific burr. This is that's always with gears, you get that kind of burr. And yeah, it's hairy. Well, next step is to get rid of that. Deburring top of these gears. And that's quite a horrific burr we have there, but you can get rid of it by just doing like this. You have now this cutter here, and then I turn this and it will actually remove the burr. Like that. There you are. Done. It's deburred. Let's see. If I just wipe off. So you can see that there is no burr. Yeah, these are really sharp, but no burr. Here it is. Now I have here a half-inch end mill. And it is tilted 15 degrees. So what I will do now, I will not with that kind of speed, a little bit more. Like that. Well, now this is what we achieved to do to do. Well, this is what we achieved today. One gear. Well, it's a very precise gear. It needs to be. So it goes into this motor like this, actually, from this way, and then it will be split. The thin part will be split, and then there will be a collar which will be squeezing it, and then it locks into the shaft of this motor. I don't want to put the key there or screws or anything like that. Those are really, in my opinion, those are not very reliable. When you do it very precisely and when you squeeze it, it's probably more tightly locked than it would be like with a grip screw. Okay. And, well, in the next episode of Finno-Ugric Machining, we will be making, well, two more of these gears and maybe the collar as well. And, well, but, as always, that will be in the next episode of Finno-Ugric Machining. Till then, bye!